All right, we're back. Let's talk Pixel 6.
Yeah.
There's a lot.
We aren't going to do it, but you are going to talk about Pixel 6. I mean, I'm excited for it, but I've said kind of what I wanted to. I know David's very excited to talk about not just Pixel 6, but Tensor and a whole lot of other stuff. So I'm going to actually relinquish my seat for the rest of the episode. David will be your host for the rest of this, and I think he's very, very excited. So
before you leave, though,
sure.
Since you're a current Pixel user, what are your like reactions to seeing Pixel 6?
I want the smaller one.
Okay.
I think.
There it is.
If I get it. If.
Interesting. We don't know a lot yet.
We don't know
a lot. Price. Okay. Let's bring in David. Got any details? Whoa. Oh, hey. Welcome.
This keeps happening.
David.
You keep
taking over the podcast, man. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Okay. We've got a bunch. This is maybe the strangest smartphone pre-announcement I've seen in a while. So what Google did was they hopped on. Well, first of all, they emailed a bunch of people behind the scenes, including me. And they were like, hey, want to come to New York City and just like check out the Pixel? But also, we're not announcing it yet. But you want to check it out and then you can talk about it. And I was like, yeah, okay, I'll take a look. And then, yeah, we went out. I saw the Pixel 6 and Pixel 6 Pro. Got lots of hands-on.
Finally a Pro. Not Ultra, but a
exactly,
Pro.
Exactly. Not an Ultra. I didn't get to shoot any video or photos of it. But I got my demos and then came back here and then made a video talking about it.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, Google spills all these details, but not a whole bunch of, like, official specs. Just a bunch of details about Pixel 6. But it's not the announcement yet.
Mm-hmm.
There's no price. You can't order it. They're going to announce it later.
Yep.
Even though they just revealed it.
This fall.
It's weird.
Yep.
So here's what they revealed. So we've got the two designs. You've probably, if you haven't seen the leaks by now, they look pretty accurate. It's got the camera bar across the back instead of the camera circle. There's a 6 and a 6 Pro that are similar in a lot of ways, but there's a few differences. The 6 has a 90 hertz display instead of the 6 Pro, which has a 120 hertz display. The 6 has a flat display with slightly bigger bezels, and the 6 Pro has a little bit of the waterfall display going on over the edges and will give you a slightly bigger 6.7 inches instead of 6.4. Slightly bigger battery, of course, in the Pro as well, but I don't have the sizes in front of me here. And then you will get a 4X telephoto camera in the Pro in addition to the cameras they share, which is the primary and the ultra-wide. And the colors are all like pretty pastel-y. There's a gray one. There's an orange peachish looking one. There's a blue green. But that's basically it. We've got the camera bar is sort of the most obvious new thing. But the one thing that I wanted to focus on that I talked about in my video about it was the new chip inside of both, which is called Google Tensor. We have a lot of thoughts on Tensor
Many
and maybe
thoughts.
Its implications. And I made the video, of course, you can check that out already. But how would you describe what Tensor is? Because it was rumored for a while.
Yeah. Okay. I'm a little mixed on the naming. I don't think the naming is going to matter that much for a lot of people. Like, I don't think regular people are like, oh, Apple A14. I want to buy it because of the A14.
Yeah.
I do actually think the name is probably good. For people that don't know, Google also makes a machine learning or deep learning library called TensorFlow.
Yep.
Right. And a tensor is basically, it's basically just like a higher order vector. So you've got scalars as a point. A vector is like a one dimensional point with direction.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got a matrix and then you've got a tensor.
Yeah.
So a tensor is basically just like, we can, in n directions, flow this information with an input and come out with an output. It's basically deep learning.
So that's how they named it.
Yes, that's why they named it Tensor.
So it is, we were hearing about the Whitechapel project before, and obviously there are other smartphone manufacturers that design their own silicon in their smartphones.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned the Exynos chip that's designed by Samsung. Kirin chips from Huawei. People always correct me when I say it wrong.
Yeah.
And obviously Apple with their A14.
Yeah.
So yeah, the Tensor chip will now be in Pixels.
Yeah.
Makes it competitive in its own unique way, but also allows them to focus on dedicating certain parts of the chip to certain things.
Yep.
And this is a lot of what they were telling me. They gave me some demos on photography. Computational photography is a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing something new now where if they take a photo of a human and the face is blurry, they're also now taking some really, really fast shutter speed shots on the ultra wide that they can merge in to get a clear face on an otherwise blurry subject.
Yeah.
Pretty cool stuff. Also, computational photography inside video is something they showed me, and they gave me a quick demo of basically like an HDR shot right into the sun against Pixel 5 and iPhone 12. And of course, it's doing all its Pixel magic. So, you know, that was tailored by them. And of course, we'll have to test that for ourselves, but that's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. And then on-device speech-to-text recognition, which covers a lot of things. It covers like obviously just texting somebody with your voice, but it also covers Google Assistant, and it also covers like turning on transcriptions or translate, and also live transcriptions that are also live translated into a different language, all happening on device. A lot of really cool stuff. We don't know the rest of the details of like how it'll benchmark and if it's equivalent to a Snapdragon 888 or an 8765. We don't really know. But we got all these details now, and we've got thoughts on them, but I'm curious, how do you feel about
it? I have so many thoughts, man.
Okay, hit me.
Okay, so here's the thing. Big reason why Apple is transitioning from Intel to ARM, for example.
On the Macs.
On the Macs, is because they're realizing that ARM was originally developed for like smartphones, right? It's reduced, it's like a reduced architecture that was originally like, let's save as much power as we can. And then over the years, because smartphones are like one of the most replaced products of all time, they were able to iterate it on it more than like any other thing, right? So ARM just became better and better and better. Apple realized like, oh, these are now basically faster than the traditional processors.
Yeah.
This is a similar transition. It's also ARM, of course, you know, because Qualcomm uses ARM architectures and then it basically like tweaks it to its own specifications. But Google here is effectively realizing that machine learning is becoming more and more and more important in our phones, right? That's the reason that Apple created the A14 Bionic, the whole like Bionic thing.
Right, because there's certain parts of that chip that are dedicated. There's like a neural core and there's the part that's specifically for Face ID and all these different biometrics, and often, ML gets looped into that.
Right, so the neural processing unit. So if we pull this back to the original Google Pixel, right? Okay.
Pixel 1, that was a classic.
Pixel 1, a classic phone. Yeah. It was the first made by Google phone. That's that's when they announced the made by Google brand. They released the Pixel 1. They released the Google Home. And then they also released, I think, Google Wi-Fi at that time. Google Wi-Fi at the time didn't have Google Assistant. But more important than the hardware that they released, than Google made phones, was the Google Assistant. Yeah. Google Assistant was their first step in doing basically like deep learning stuff on your device, and more importantly, ambient computing. Google's future is ambient computing, which is to say you don't have to interact with your device that much, right? Everything that you should be doing should be able to be done just with your voice, or it should predict things for you. It's kind of like that Elon Musk, like, any input is failure of the system. Basically, Google wants the Google Assistant to be all around you at all times. And that's why now if you go in the Google store, they offer so many products that are all made to be all around you all the time.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a bunch of parts of this that I'm curious about. Obviously, we have other assistants that work in their own ways, Siri and Alexa, and what's the one that's Cortana is another one. But Google Assistant, Google Assistant to me tends to be the most consistent and the most helpful because it knows the most about me, but also it's the most proactive. A lot of times it's already about to tell me what the traffic is to work before I even leave.
Right.
Stuff like that is really cool. So I imagine Tensor, you know, putting your own design silicon in the phone you make is a step to sort of centralize and maximize this advantage that they have.
Right.
Like Siri on the iPhone, while it's decent, it as currently constructed, I feel like it can never match what Google Assistant does because Apple's so focused on privacy that there's so much that they don't know about you. And they try to map it out and do a good job about that. But Google sort of shamelessly knows a lot about you and is constantly ambiently computing with that information.
Right.
So Tensor is just another way of optimizing and speeding up and centralizing that on the Pixel and making it. Does it make it a buying point for the Pixel? Is that a reason people will buy Pixel 6?
Okay, here I think is Google's core problem.
Okay.
Is it will make the experience way better because all of the reasons to buy Pixel are all of the things that Google Assistant does and the ways that Pixel are smart, right? Like or not even just Google Assistant, but the machine learning chops that Google has. That's what has.
I, yeah. So because I was just going to say that, not to interrupt, the camera on the Pixel mm-hmm. is a feature that people care about
yes,
a lot.
Yes.
The reason the camera is good is because of Google's software prowess yeah. with machine learning.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because like computational photography, everything is kind of using machine learning, right? Mm-hmm. Like it is using machine learning to know if that face is blurry. It'll always take another photo with the wide camera, and then it uses machine learning to clear up, you know, it'll crop in with the wide camera, clear up that area with machine learning, and then make the face not blurry.
It's crazy.
But they have this like whole ambient computing push where they don't want you to have to interact with your devices that often. And when I reviewed the like Pixel 4a and the Pixel 5, I basically was like, well, it's okay that these phones are like not pro phones in a way, because they make you not need to touch them as often. You've got things like Now Playing on your phone, so you glance at your phone when you're in a coffee shop and you already know the song that's playing.
It's one of my favorite features.
You've got Hold For Me, so if you're making a call, it can like hold for you. You've got call screening, so you don't have to really touch your phone that much. Like mm-hmm. Google's whole thing. And if you go on their website right now, they have so many products that you can buy that all have Google Assistant built in. Now the Nest Wi-Fi, which yep. used to be Google Wi-Fi, has Google Assistant built in. You've got the Nest Cams. There's just like all of these products with Google Assistant. So I think their end goal is Google Assistant should be able to sort of do everything for you. And Google's just been so good at deep learning mm-hmm. compared to every other company ever because they have the most data. Because mm-hmm. they're Google. They have everything. They have the internet's, they have the internet.
Google knows a lot about
yeah.
me. Like
yeah.
a lot.
And not even just about you, but just about like trends and yeah. everything and like
about what I'm likely to do and likely to become.
Yeah.
It's kind of
yeah.
scary. yeah. It's like funny. We yeah. were checking the other day about like, oh, how many cities have we been to? How many states have we been to? And uh-huh. we're like, how do I even figure out for myself how many places I've been to? I could just sort of count back in my memory. Or you could open the Google Maps like timeline and it'll give you a bunch of points on a map where you've ever been.
Yeah.
Because you have your phone on you at all times. It's like yeah. they know so much about you.
Yeah.
Okay, so do we, just to go back to Tensor and the
Tensor.
Pixel.
Yeah.
Pixel 6 and Pixel 6 Pro, I'm going to guess what I think the prices will be.
Okay.
Just the way they were talking about them and the way I saw them built and after holding them, I feel like we can say, or at least I'll say, I think Pixel 6 Pro is going to be right around $1,000.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Pixel 6 is going to be right around that $750 mark where we saw like, you know, OnePlus 8 and Galaxy S20 FE and a lot of those phones,
mm-hmm.
which is, you know, it's expensive, but it's competitive-ish in that way.
Yeah.
Do you think this brings Pixel to, like, the finally competitive flagship landscape that we've been hoping for, or is it going to take more than just Tensor and
so,
a nice screen?
Yeah, this is the problem. Is like, Google is so focused on making the experience for you amazing. And seamless. Their whole thing is ambient computing, which means that you shouldn't have to worry about things. Things should just happen for you. And the experience that they offer on Pixel with things like their deep learning algorithms is so amazing. Unfortunately, from a marketing perspective, it's really hard to market that. Like you can say like Pixel is delightful. A lot of people will call Pixels delightful.
Helpful. But
helpful. Like Google uses that term all the time. But yeah. unless you have like a headline feature like the camera, right? Everybody mm-hmm. uses the camera. Everyone knows Pixel cameras are great. So I really hope that they're really pushing how much better these cameras are now, especially since they're finally putting new
hardware
in it.
Oh yeah,
thank goodness.
I'm excited for that. By the way,
very.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. That's a good point. Like if they had like a really catchy, maybe not just slogan, but like an entire campaign.
Yeah. Because
they've flirted with this. They've talked about like how. I don't know if exactly the way they phrase it, but how like Google works for you.
Yeah.
Or like let Google
do it.
Do it for you.
That's
yeah,
a whole
something
campaign.
Like that.
Yeah. Let Google
and it's
do
like it.
It
makes sense to me because I know what they mean, but I just don't see it clicking
yeah.
with a lot of people.
You know what's funny though is they had their earnings call recently and they told the investors, by the way, we're gonna be spending a lot more money than usual near the second half of the year for the holiday season, which means they're going to market the crap out of Pixel 6 and Pixel 6 Pro.
I'm very interested.
I think they really, really wanna get past that like single digit like penetration number in the US market share.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, when I say that's a similar, that Tensor is a similar transition as from like x86 to ARM. It's because like companies like Qualcomm have upped the amount of machine learning cores that they're dedicating in their chips. Like Qualcomm is doing a good job of like scaling that up more and more. But I think Google is realizing sort of like single core CPU performance and multi-core CPU performance are fine. But we've kind of gotten to this point where the chips are fast enough that you don't really notice slowdowns. So let's go over here and just like put a ton of resources into the thing that isn't quite there yet for everybody, yeah. Right? Like just allowing your phone to seamlessly do all the deep learning stuff as seamless as possible. Mm-hmm. And then Tensor is like you said in your video, Tensor is so important because you can scale it up to bigger hardware. You can scale it down for things like watches. And then Google also cuts out the middleman. They can make it cheaper. And so when you did the pricing guess, I'm a little mixed. I'm like, they've gone through this, right? They've done the premium Pixel mm-hmm. where they charge $1,000. They've done the cheap Pixel where they charged $700.
$349 for the A series?
I mean, for the A series.
So that's the baseline.
For the A series. Okay. But then if we're talking about like Pixel 5,
yeah.
That was what?
$799.
At launch? Is that $699 or $799?
I think it launched at $799 and then obviously dropped.
I have a feeling they're going to try to make it $899 for the Pro.
Mm. Okay.
And $699 for the non-pro. Because I think a $250 delta is kind of a lot for people, especially since the only thing you're losing, you're only losing a couple things on the smaller one.
Yeah, that is true. Like when you think about putting those phones next to each other in the store, one of them is going to be slightly smaller. One of them is going to have an extra camera that a lot of people don't really know what to make of. Like, mm-hmm. The iPhone Pro has an extra camera, but as far as I can tell, people aren't buying it for that.
Yeah.
It'll have a little bit of a bigger screen. And that's kind of it. Same exact chip, same exact software. Mm-hmm. And a lot of people haven't noticed the difference between 90 and 120 hertz, so that's not a differentiator either.
Yeah.
For the Pro name, you know, I feel like anytime you see Pro in a name, you immediately go, oh, okay, it's going to cost more. Yeah, it's the better one, obviously, but like, what are the real features? But mm-hmm. this phone isn't going to really have that many different features versus the regular Pixel 6. So you're right. It probably can't be that different in price from each other. Oh, look, you made it to the end of the clip. Congrats. You didn't make it to the end of smartphone season, though. That's still like coming up soon. So you're probably going to want to hit a couple buttons. Hit that subscribe button. Hit that like button if you like the video. There's also down there, there's like a little bell button. You're going to want to ring that bell.
It up.
And we'll see you guys in the next one.
I get ready for the piece this time and you don't do it.